गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल. वी विल बी स्टार्टिंग विद द न्यू मॉड्यूल दैट इज इन आईओ इंटरफेसिंग. सो फ्रॉम द बिगिनिंग यू सॉ वी टॉक्ड अबाउट एम्बेडेड सिस्टम, हाउ थिंग्स हैपन इनसाइड इट, वेरियस टाइप ऑफ आईसी, हाउ डू वी पैकेज इट, व्हाट ऑल द चैलेंजेस क्रिएटेड बाय रियल टाइम सर्किट्स, हाउ डू वी सॉल्व इट, ऑल दैट वी हैव सीन. This is your second last module in which we will be seeing how to interface your IO. So now we have moved out of the packaging of the IC. We have to see how various input devices and output devices are interfaced with our IC, interfaced with our embedded system. Because when you are using any system in a whole, you also have all the IO devices attached with it. So what all we use, under what technology it is used, and how things are taken care in that, all that we have to see in this module. Okay, so now input output devices and transducers. You all know what is transducer. Transducer is something which convert a physical signal to a electrical signal. Because in real world, everything is not in electrical measures. It is in different, whether it is temperature, pressure, or level, anything, any physical measurement has to be converted to digital or electrical signal so that we are able to work on it using our embedded system. Because the embedded system understands only voltage, only electrical signal it understands. So, input transducer means which converts outside physical environment to the electrical signal. So that is a broad term, it is called as sensors. So sensor, what does it do? It senses the outside world and it converts to electrical signal. Now you all know that outside world or real world is full of analog signal. So whenever we take input from any sensors, whenever we take any input from sensor, it will be in analog form. So because physical real world is in analog form, we will require an analog to digital converter along with our input transducers of sensors. Because after it is converted to digital signal, then only we will be able to work on it using our embedded system. Because embedded system is actually your digital embedded system. Now coming to output transducer. Now, what do you mean by output transducer? So you imagine that you had to control temperature of a room. So a sensor has sensed the temperature. It converted to electrical signal, which was converted to digital form. It went inside the embedded system, the chip which is connected to your AC. Now, what the chip has to see? Chip has to see that, okay, the temperature of the room is high. You need to lower it. How that it will lower? It will go and give a command to compressor to act accordingly. Now this command to compressor is the output of your chip, the embedded chip, embedded system in your AC. So what will happen? Input has gone in a digital form, which was converted by the sensor and further ADC. Now this control signal out of the chip, that how much degree the compressor has to work more, that is the control signal. So that calculation, that is difference of the temperature, amount of compressor work, all that signals will come out of the output device, output transducer. So output transducer is also called as actuator. Why it is called as actuator? Because it actually drives the signal. It actually drives the signal. That is why it is called as actuator. Now, when your embedded system chip is giving the signal out, it again has to be in the real world. Real world is again physical. Physical world is again analog in the nature. So this actuator will be also converting your digital output of embedded system to analog, so that that signal will be able to control your compressor or any other physical environment thing which is analog in nature. तो इट मे रिक्वायर डिजिटल टू एनालॉग कन्वर्टर. सो इनपुट इज सेंसर, आउटपुट इज एक्चुएटर. इनपुट कन्वर्जन फ्रॉम आउटसाइड वर्ल्ड टू एम्बेडेड सिस्टम टू सो एनालॉग टू डिजिटल. आउटपुट मीन्स कन्वर्जन फ्रॉम एम्बेडेड सिस्टम टू आउटसाइड वर्ल्ड, सो इट विल बी डिजिटल टू एनालॉग. नाउ यू हैव यूज मेनी एम्बेडेड सिस्टम बाय नाउ, सो यू नो वॉट टाइप ऑफ ह्यूमन इंटरफेस डिवाइसिस कम्स. देर विल बी बटन्स, स्विचेज, नॉब्स, की पैड, माउस, एंड दिस इज अबाउट इनपुट डिवाइस. What about output? Output device are like indicators, displays, speakers, etc. So these things are your output device. Now we will have to see each one, how does it work. Now this is about keypad and keyboard. You have used a several time such a keypad. Now you need to know how does it work. So how does it work? You have to see that you have a array type like this. Array like this means you have 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 and these. So what you can see, how many switches are there? There are in total 12 switches. Now you see this diagram. In this diagram you can see R1 R2 R3 and R4 are connected. If no switch is pressed, if there is no switch pressed, you will be able to see that each column C1, C2, C3 is connected to this plus V through these resistor. So the value of the voltage in this C1, C2, C3 will be high. High means what? It will be pulled high to plus V. The small drop of this resistor will be there, but it will be approximately equal to high voltage only. So when there is no switch pressed, that time all these column C1, C2, C3 values will be high. Now, if any specific switch is pressed, for example, if this 5 is pressed, what will happen? If 5 is pressed, you see the connection. R2 through this switch 5 through this C2. So this connection get established. So C2 will be pulled low. Why low? Because when we sense, we make R2 low. So now how things happen is, okay, you understand this very carefully now. Just a second. Okay, you see very carefully now that to sense there will be a counter set which will scan R1, R2, R3, R4 in regular interval of time. So what will happen? R1 will be made low, next count R2 will be made low, next count R3 will be made low, next count R4 will be made low, again R1, R2, R3, R4. This way a cycle keeps on happening here, and R1 to R4 is made low one after the other regularly, means scanning. So whenever the chance for R2 low comes, that time what we will see, if I make R1 low, no switches are pressed, so C1, C2, C3 will remain high even when R1 is made low. But when R2 is made low, that time what will happen? C2 will become low, C1 and C3 will not become low. So we will understand that C2 is becoming low when R2 made low, that means 5 is pressed. So this is how pressing of a button is scanned in this system. So what happens? This scanning happens regularly. Again, for example, if any time in one row two buttons are pressed, suppose if two buttons are pressed, so if switch number 4 and switch number 5 both are pressed, then what happens? When the scanning times come for R2 and R2 is made low, that time what will happen? C1 as well as C2 will be made low. So they will understand that two buttons are pressed. And if a system does not allow it, it will not take that reading. And this, there are various ways of controlling such mechanism. But there is a control to see whether one key is pressed or which key is pressed. So this is how things are done here. Now, you would have understood that, yes, okay, this matrix form with only 4 wires on left-hand side and 3 wires on downside, we will be able to scan all these switches. You would have understood this. I'm sure about that. But Now, how it is actually implemented in embedded system, that is important to understand. So the embedded system, what does it do? The embedded software will be running on a processor, which will be scanning this matrix repeatedly. And also it should detect a key closure, and it should also check whether the same key is still closed after some time, maybe around after 10 millisecond or 5 millisecond, it is still pressed or not. Same way, it has to detect a key release also. So if a key is released, it should check again whether same key remains released sometime later or not. That means what? This scanning must be repeated sufficiently so that to debounce key presses and without introducing any delay in response of key presses. So now you have to imagine that you have a counter playing, you have a counter working, and that is why how it is implemented. One output register is connected to the rows, and input register is connected to the columns. So that will be taking care of which keys are pressed, and this input register will be having all the register value with C1, C2, C3. All the values will be high only. So now what will happen? To drive the row lines through this output register chip, what we have, we in the circuitry, it stores the count value, and also it will be running the count based upon the rows. So with that counter, R1, R2, R3, R4 will be made low regularly based upon the counter frequency, and it will also know that this count R1 is low, this count R2 is low, this count R3 is low. So it is not only understanding the working of keypad you should know, you should also know how it is interfaced with the embedded system. So this is how it is interfaced and working. You should know both the things. So I hope this is clear. And this synchronizing the processor with change in count value so that we can the software could read the values at the appropriate time. This is important. Okay, so this you have to understand working of this circuitry, also how it is interfaced. So please remember this counter thing and the connection also. So this is about keypad and keyboards. If you have a big keyboard the way your laptop has, the matrix value will be higher. And if it is a small keypad, the matrix value will be lower. Okay. Now coming to knobs and position encoder. Knobs and position encoder, what I had told before with the keypad was, it is about a digital input going with the pressed button. Now for the analog knobs, you all know you have used the regulator of your fans. What do you know what is there inside it? You simply have a variable resistor, and you have seen in your DRB and DCB in your analog circuit lab also. You have an analog circuit. In that analog circuit, you have a variable resistor, and the value of resistor changes when you move that knob. So that is a simple type of thing what you have seen for many times. What we have to understand today is about the digital circuit, digital knob also. So in digital knob, you have seen in your fun in the function generator in the lab, you have push buttons also to increase and decrease the frequency. Same way you have some push buttons. If you press one of the push button, volume will go up. If you press the other push button, volume will go down. Same way with your frequency used to increase with plus on your frequency generator, and a minus with the frequency generator used to decrease. So that type of push buttons are also there. No, nothing difficult to understand that. Now coming to knobs or sliders, we have something called as position encoder attached to a knob. Now you see this diagram. This is incremental encoder. Now again, it's little difficult to understand, so try to understand it with me. Okay, now you have seen certain knob in the instrument what you have used in your lab. Some knobs will be, there is no final position of the knob. If you keep on moving it clockwise, things keeps on increasing. If you keep on moving it counterclockwise, it keeps on reducing. There is no final position of a knob. There is no absolute, there is no final position, and there is no range of the knob to move. The way what you have used as DRV and DCV in your lab, you see that there is a final position. After that, it will not move. And if you try to move it, you will break it. So that is a different type of switch. A switch where there is no final position is this absolute position will be not important. Only incremental or decremental thing will be important. So how that works is what I will be telling you now. Now, see what is there. You can see this is a knob, and along with this knob there are these two encoder attached, two concentric circle. You can see the inner one is labeled for B, outer one is labeled for A. Okay, now you imagine that you are moving this knob clockwise. So what will happen if you move this knob clockwise? Your A will be leading your B. A will be leading your B. So you have to understand that it is this knob position is related or associated with A movement. So when you are moving this A clockwise, your A will be moving clockwise. And if A is moving clockwise, A will be leading B. So you can see the waveform generated from A is this one and B is this one. When you are moving A clockwise, A is leading B by 90 degree. A is in lead position than B by 90 degree. So with this, we understand that the user is trying to increase the volume or increase the frequency or increase whatever. So it is a continuous increase. Same way when you are doing counterclockwise, now you see what will happen. This A will be moving. This A will be moving and B will be in lead. So here you can see B is in lead and A is in lag. B is 90 degree in lead compared to A. So this shows that user is trying to decrease the volume, decrease the frequency or however. Now, to make you understand, I have used this waveform. But how a machine understands? Machine understands with this. Can you see this? This is only the encoding mechanism. Now the same thing you can see from the top view now. When you are moving A clockwise, when you are moving A clockwise, this, the signal generated because of this markings here, the signal generated because of this, and the value of it compared with respect to the inner circle will be showing that A is in a lead position. And if you leave it like this and switch off your system, when you come back, this position will be maintained. That is why when you switch off your TV or your music system in a high volume, and next time when you switch it on, it will be in the same volume. Why? Because this will be stored there. This will be stored and it will start with the same value. So of course, the final value to where it can increase will be limited by the system. Whatever you are using, music system can go to the highest value of some decibel. Of course, it will go till there only. This is just the connection between user and the this is our input signal which is given to the music system or whatever in a form of digital form, which will go and increase its volume or decrease its volume. So it is one of the input transducer. Input transducer, the physical input we are giving by increasing the volume or moving the knob, which is converted in the digital form, and it goes inside the embedded system to tell whether the user want to increase or decrease or do what with it. So this is another transducer. One transducer what I taught you was keypad. This is second transducer, input transducer. It is about the knob, the incremental encoder. Okay, so this is about incremental encoder. Other analog inputs what you have is microphone, accelerometer, fluid flow sensor, and gas detector. You need to know the working of each one of it. So all of you should listen carefully. I will be telling you few of it you may know. So let us revise that part. That is not a problem. But to start with, microphone. You all may be knowing that microphone is connected to mic, and it, what does it do? It senses the amount of our voice. It records that. So what, and it is the most common sensor in our everyday life. How does it work? Let us know that a microphone has a diaphragm that is displaced by the sound pressure waves. When we speak, the sound waves which comes from our mouth, that creates a sound pressure waves. Okay. Now there is a capacitor type of thing connected inside this microphone transducer. If you get a chance, you can open one microphone and see, spoiled one, you can open and see what is there inside. You will be able to see that there are plates of capacitor. So the diaphragm forms one plate of capacitor which moves with our sound pressure waves, and the other plate of the capacitor is fixed and has a permanent charge embedded on it during manufacture time only, and that charge does not change. That is a permanent charge intact, and it is done at the time of manufacture only. Now when we speak, our produced sound pressure waves goes and move the second diaphragm, which is one of the plate of the capacitor, and the movement of that plate with that the displacement, and you know the capacitor value is dependent upon the distance between the two capacitor plates, you know that, right? So this movement of the plate together and apart in response to sound pressure creates a detectable voltage across the plate that vary with the sound pressure. So what does what happens by displacing the capacitor, that diaphragm, one of the plate, voltage changes, voltage of the capacitor produced voltage changes, and that only is your input physical value converting to electrical. But this voltage is a very small value, so it has to be amplified. So this is amplified and then it forms the analog input signal. I hope your microphone is clear. Microphone is clear with its working. Next comes your accelerometer. Now you know where accelerometer is used. Accelerometer is used in various automobiles, in airbag controller also. So it measures acceleration when your car is moving, and it also measures declaration when you suddenly put a brake, and if this declaration is too high, then your airbag also opens. So we need to know how this accelerometer works. It is a small device only. You can simply Google and see how it looks like. So now let me tell you how does it work. So you know that microphone is working with the principle of capacitor. Actually, accelerometer also works in principle of capacitor only. But you know what is cantilever? Cantilever is something, a beam whose one side is connected to any fixed thing and other side is hanging. Okay, one side is connected, other side is hanging. So it is a cantilever. So cantilever will be more free to move because one side is connected, other side is not connected. So it has a cantilevered beam. It has a microscopic accelerometer, has a microscopic cantilevered beam manufactured on a silicon chip, and the beam and the surface over where it is suspended forms a two plate of a capacitor. Now you imagine one plate of capacitor is lying fixed in any region, and other capacitor plate is fixed at one side and it is hanging on the fixed capacitor plate. It is hanging over this fixed capacitor plate. So now it is hanging. Now you imagine when there is no movement, it will be nicely intact without any change in this hanging cantilevered plate of the capacitor. But as this chip accelerates, or if it decelerate, then what happens? This beam bends closer to or farther from the surface. Now you try to imagine what is happening. There is a capacitor, one side fixed, another capacitor is hanging over this fixed plate. When the vehicle or when anything moves front, it will be this second plate, it will be bending closer. But if suddenly you put a brake, it will move farther away from the surface. So this change in the capacitor value is again used to derive the analog signal. Of course, this also has to be amplified. So again, capacitor is used in the accelerometer. Now coming on to the next part, fluid flow sensor. You must be remembering your electronic instrumentation subject where all these will come, but here it is very short and it is faster covered in this. Now fluid flow sensor, you know that when a fluid is flowing in a pipe, you need to know how fast it is flowing. And whenever you are controlling a big, you can imagine any machinery or a factory where you require the fluid flow for certain type of manufacturing unit, then you need to know with what speed this fluid should flow. So this fluid flowing, how it is controlled. Now, there are various sensors which rely on different effects to sense the flow. So what we are understanding here is temperature dependent resistor. Okay, temperature dependent resistor. So what will happen? There will be two matched resistor which are self-heated using an electric current. You all know that resistor value, any resistance value depend upon the temperature also. So when it depends upon the temperature, if the temperature of that resistor changes, the resistance value will change. So to start with the operation, both the resistors are, they are matched. How it is matched? It is self-heated using an electric current, and both will be showing the same resistance value. Now, one of this resistor is placed inside the fluid stream. Inside the fluid stream, in the pipe, wherever this fluid is flowing, one of the resistor is kept inside that fluid stream. Now, when the fluid flows, when this stream flows, it cools the resistance environment by an amount which depends upon the flow rate. Now, as the resistance depends on the temperature, the difference in the resistor between these two resistance will be depending on the flow rate. So one of the resistance is kept outside, it is kept outside, and another is kept inside that stream. So when the stream flows, with what rate the fluid is flowing, with that rate only the resistor temperature will be brought down, and this difference is detected by the difference in the resistor between these two resistors. And this difference is detected and to derive the analog input signal. This is one type of fluid flow sensor. There are many types available in the market. One type what is available is this type, resistor based. other forms are also there which use rotating vanes. Rotating vanes means what? If fluid is flowing in a high speed, this rotation will happen in a high speed. And if it is low flow, the rotation will happen in the low speed. So this is also one of the way. Then we have pressure sensing, venture restriction, Doppler effect are also used. So there are many different form of sensor to understand this fluid flow sensor. Now the next one, what we have to see is the gas detection sensor. Now gas detection is used in various safety equipment. And what do we use in this is a photo ionizing detector. Photo ionizing detector. You all know that gas ions are attracted as the concentration of gas is more, it has it is more capable of giving a better path for the current. So what is used in this is it is a photo ionizing detector which uses ultraviolet light to ionize a sample of atmosphere. So you imagine now a photo ionizing detector is placed which is ionized using ultraviolet light. Now it is ionized. So because it is ionized, it has its own capacity. Now gas ions are attracted to these plates and which are held at a potential difference. See, you imagine that you have different plates. You have different plates which are kept at a certain potential difference. Two plates are there. Now the circuit path between these two plates will depend upon it will depend upon the charge provided between the two plates. Now the current in this path depends upon the concentration of the gas in this atmospheric sample. If the concentration of gas is more, the current path will be the charge provided and the current path will be more. So this current only is sensed. This current is sensed and this is equivalent to the amount of gas present in that atmosphere. So this is sensed and of course this current value is again low. It is amplified to form the analog input signal. So this is about your analog input. So how many analog inputs we saw? We saw the keypad. Next we saw the knob, positional encoder. And then other analog input what we saw is microphone, accelerometer, fluid flow sensor and gas detector sensor. Now all analog inputs over. Now next what we have to do, we know that analog inputs will be in analog form. So we should know the method to convert it to digital form. So digital form, how do we do? There are two methods what you have to study under this unit. One is analog to digital converter. This what is there on your screen. And other one is one more, which is successive approximation analog to digital converter. Now what is there on your screen is flash ADC now. Now let us see the working of this. With that, with working of these two, I think this class will be over. Now flash ADC. Let us understand the working of this flash ADC. You have to understand that you have an analog input signal which should be converted to a digital signal. Okay, so your analog input signal is this Vin. Okay, and VF is the reference voltage. Now you can see these many resistors are connected. So it forms a voltage divider circuit. Now how many resistors you are able to see here is only six. But you can see two dots here means more resistors are connected. You can imagine that there are eight resistors connected here. So if this VF is suppose 5 volts and eight equal resistors are connected. So you can imagine the amount of current flowing in this path and what will be the voltage here. This voltage will be the current into this resistor. with respect to ground. So this will be the least value of voltage. When two resistor comes into picture, this value will be more, then this will be more, and so on, the value will be increasing. So how does it work? You input your V in value. Suppose you imagine that you have inputted 3 volts here. So this 3 volts is available on all the plus terminal of these comparators. These are all comparators. So this plus 3 volt is available in all the comparators. Now this plus 3 voltage will be more than this. Yes, of course, plus 3 voltage will be more than this. So output of this comparator will be high. 1 you will get here. Now coming to this, whether the plus 3 voltage, which is coming here, is more than this voltage. Yes, it may be. So this may also be high. So you can understand now, your input voltage is here, and based upon what resistor value you have kept, it will, all the comparator will have different values at its negative terminal. So based upon the value of V in voltage, a few of the comparator will be giving 0 output and a few comparator will be giving the high output. So this down comparator are LSBs and up comparator are MSBs. So now in this example, we can imagine that these 3 comparators will be, give you high, 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 and upper comparators will give you 0, 0, 0. Why? Because by that time, this voltage will be higher than your input voltage. So if negative terminal voltage is higher than positive terminal, output will be 0. So these output of this so many comparator connected in parallel will be given to this encoder, and this encoder will be taking this input and will be giving the output in a digital form. So this is called as flash ADC. Why it is called flash ADC? Because it is simple, fast, and immediately the analog is converted to digital converter. Analog is converted to digital signal. And resolution. What do you mean by resolution? Resolution is how many bits information you are giving. So resolution basically depends upon the number of resistor connected. Now you imagine if I would have connected only 3 resistor, you would have only 3 bits for the answer. So the resolution is less. If the number of bits are more, that means number of resistors and number of comparators are more, the resolution is more. So resolution depends upon the number of output bits, in turn number of comparator, in turn number of resistor. Generally, 8-bit ADC is used. So this is about your analog to digital converter, flash ADC. Okay, this one is successive approximation ADC. Successive approximation ADC, I would like you to analyze this diagram for some time and see if you can understand something out of it. If you have any doubt in between, you can ask me with the chat window. Okay, so let me start the explanation of successive approximation ADC. Okay, now what you can see, why this is required? This is required because the previous one, flash ADC, required so many resources. So many resources means just for a conversion, it required 8 comparator, 8 resistor, then your encoder. So it is a very expensive circuit. So we have another version, which is successive approximation ADC. But this successive approximation ADC will be doing it a little slower. It will take 8 cycle time. Previous one will do in 1 cycle only. This one will successively do it for run for eight cycle time. Then only you will get the output. Now see the circuit. You have a successive approximation resistor. This SAR is successive approximation resistor. It has a start control input signal. When you give the clock input and if you start, it starts. It starts, and what does it do? It goes and activates your DAC. What is DAC? DAC is digital to analog converter. So this ADC system has a DAC inbuilt in it. So what happens, your input signal is entered in this one comparator, and your VF, your reference voltage, that is also analog, that is digital in nature. VF, it is digital in nature, and which is entered here, and it converts to analog, because this comparator will be comparing the input signal with the converted analog input signal of what? Of the reference voltage. VF is the reference voltage. Okay, so now you see what happens. First, what happens at VF, you will be giving at VF in the initial state when the start input is activated, the successive approximation register is initialized to the binary value of 0 and all ones. So this is initial approximation. So this is what is entered here. This is what is entered here, and this is what is compared. Now, if this comparison happens, and if the comparator output gives either 1 or 0, it will give 1 if your Vin is high. It will give 0 if your Vin is less. So if whatever it gives, that will be called as D7. So if that means if Vin is higher than what? Higher than all this. If higher than all this, a high will come here. And this high is what? 1. And then 1 will be approximated at D7 as 1. Next comparison will happen with 1 here, this 0 and all 1s. So you imagine what will happen? This is how much value? This is how much value? All 1 means it is a 255, right? If this one, first bit is 0, this is half of 255. So half of 255, approximately it will be 126, right? So it is compared to 126. If input was higher than that, that output of 1, which forms D7, is stored like this. So that is why you can see this feedback here. This 1 goes back inside this SAR, and this SAR now will give you the, for the next cycle, D7, 0 and all 1. Now the comparison is happening for D6 bit, now your Vin, if it is higher than 1, 0, all 1s, it will give a 1. If it is not, it will give a 0, and whatever it gives will go back as D6 and get stored in your SAR with D6. So this happens all the time. So we keep this bit, whatever we are analyzing, as 0 and do this comparison, and this happens from D7 to D0. So that means 8 times this will happen. Once 8 times this happens for 8 clock cycles, after that, whatever is stored will be D7 to D0 will be stored in this successive approximation register. Once that is done, this done output control signal will be high, and whatever it has stored till that time, D7 to D0, you will get your Dout word of 8 bit, which is the conversion of the given analog input signal. So you can see it is very simple, nice thing. The only problem is that it will take 8 clock cycles. So advantage is that it is using very less resources, only one SAR, DAC, and only one comparator. And what is the disadvantage? Disadvantage is it will take little more time. So if you want a high precision ADC, you have to do this work for more number of bits. So 12 bit successive approximation ADCs are commonly available in the market. The only disadvantage is more time required. And one more thing, if your input signal changes by more than this precision of ADC, what will happen? If the input is changing for more than this, we will have to use one extra sample and hold input. Sample and hold input, I hope you know what it is. sample and hold circuit will be able to hold the given signal for some time. And what is there inside a sample and hold circuit? There is a capacitor. So this requires a circuit that charges a capacitor to match the input voltage during a brief sampling interval, which is required to hold that signal for the time when your successive approximation ADC is converting the previous signal, the previous sample. So for till that time, I need to hold. My data should not get lost. So that is why I need to hold. And that holding is done using a sample and hold circuit. If the speed of my conversion is less than the speed of the signal which is sent for conversion. So that is how all this is implemented in an embedded processor. So what all is there in an embedded processor? One sample and hold circuit and this successive approximation ADC. So you can see that how it is. What is the main differences? Based upon the application, we decide which one to use. So now to today's class, we completed the input part, analog input and interface part we have converted. In the next class, we will see this output devices. And output devices means we will also see digital to analog converter. So all these output devices and the Verilog program related to this, we will be seeing in the next class. And all the input and ADC is seen in today's class.